When you are a researcher, it is useless to say I am a researcher. It's much better, more convincing to say what you find. For example, here I can tell to companies, to the donors, you will say you have many donors, about 40 of them, we may say, did you see that you can grow a tree in a former electrical bulb? And that's a profitable investment you should look at. Green economy, green jobs, green investment. We may also say to European Commission, some people of the European Commission are there, that's good to recycle the old bulbs because they may be a recipient to green growth. That's the way we think today, and that's the way I will do with you. Of course, I will simulate the old presentation, that's the Florence School, that's the Loyola de Palacio chair. We have a structure, we have funding Pfizer, we have an organization. We are very proud of our funding Pfizer, and several of them are there. Pippo Ranci, not only founder of the Florence School, but also CEO and AGAG. Ignacio Perez Arriaga. Ignacio was with us 1 hour ago. Ignacio is the founder of the training at Florence School. And also Jorge. Jorge is a little bit the father of everyone and everything in the European energy area. And most of them are still working with us and advising us. Structures, I will skip. And then areas. As you can see, you now have, for the same price, 3 Florence Schools. One is dedicated to transport. It is directed by Matthias Finger, a Swiss regulator and a professor at EPFL. But this school has its own funding, its own activity, so let's forget it. We also have Florence School Communication and Media, but the same. It is directed by Pierluigi Parcu with his own funding, his own activity, let's forget. And then Florence School Energy with my humble person to take care. If we look closer at Florence School Energy, we see that some things are new under my own photography. One of the newest things you can see is Lee Hanscher. Lee Hanscher is one of the leading lawyers in European energy law. She is now responsible for our law activity. She has close ties with regulators, notably Bundesnetz Agentur, to conceive and to run workshops in European energy law. And you can see that Lee has already her own funding. A similar things did happen with Daniel Herman. Daniel Herman is the former director of the Laboratory for Environment and Energy Policy at MIT, the real MIT, Boston, Massachusetts. Today, Denis is working with us. He's responsible for our climate policy unit. Denis does not have any sponsor. Till today, he did refuse to be sponsored. I could not tell you for the next year. He, for the moment, he prefers to do a classical research. He did win a tender opened by DG Climate and is actually today funded entirely by DG Climate. Another area is working well at Florence School. It is the one of network of regulators. Regulators have several international networks. One pretty well known by George, my dear friend of the first rank, is the World Forum. The World Forum of Energy Regulators assemble up to 300 different regulatory authorities. And it's very, very open and interesting open discussion club. This forum did create, under the chairmanship of Pippo Ranci, IRN, being a data set where regulators can give and harmonize information about their roles, their activities, their goals, etc. MEDREG is an official association of Mediterranean regulators, and we are their, let's say, their secretariat, not the official secretariat, but their, let's say, research secretariat, trainee secretariat, And today the chairman is an Algerian regulator. And we also do intellectual secretariat for ICER, being the biggest of these new regulatory associations. ICER is covering both Americas, Europe, Africa, Asia, and Russia. It's a very big association of regulators. And the chair is presently Lord Mogg, the British regulator. You may imagine that France could, being that big or that dynamic, is burning a lot of cash. This cash is coming in a notable amount from companies. You may see there that we have 27 very close donors. You did already see that Lee Hanscher has 6 or 7 donors, and 5 or 6 are at the Loyola de Palacio chair. So in the energy sector, we have about 40 donors. What do we do? That's the most interesting part. We do all of this. There is 35 bubbles. So you can take a nap, because it will last about 35 minutes to look at. And that's it. We do so many things that myself, I cannot remember. So I need my team to remember everything we do. You see that it is organized as cells. So we have activity areas. And in each activity area, several things are done. Let's start with research. We are very proud to do research. When I did arrive at Florence School 4 years ago, research was occupying 1.5 equivalent full-time. Today, there are 12 full-time plus 2 part-time, so let's say 13. What do they do? We can look at it through topics, but it will take ages to give the detail of the topics. One has been gas security of supply. It's not so revolutionary. Another one has been energy network regulation within a climate change policy, which is changing the goals and the key performance indicators for network. Another one as being the feasibility of a Schengen-like European energy policy. It is an energy policy which is not driven by, let's say, European Commission, but by member states themselves. However, they drive it in a totally European-compatible format, which is typically what Schengen is, the Schengen Agreement. I won't enter into the other topics, because I do think that time is needed to give the topics, and I have no time. So I prefer to enter into it through projects. Projects, as you can imagine, is an activity ending with a report, ending with a deliverable. The first big research activity we have is called SYNC. And you are going to hear from SYNC through Leo and Sophia, the two team leaders. SYNC is made of 6 full-time researchers. They are totally complying with the gender criterion. It is spontaneous. We do not use gender to hire people, but the young generation is spontaneously equilibrated regarding the genders. You will see that the old generation, me and my colleagues, we are absolutely not complying with the gender criterion. What do they do? Let's see.
So why did the European Commission ask us for advice on this topic? First, you have to know the context. The European Union is on a path towards a low-carbon energy system by 2050. The building sector is very important to reach that goal because it is responsible for about 40% of energy consumption and greenhouse gas emissions in Europe. The problem is that the lifetime of these buildings is very long, so that most of the buildings that are around today will still be in 2050. Therefore, we need to invest in building refurbishment. We are already investing, but not enough and not sufficiently energy focused.
Each THINK report follows an identical 6-month process with 2 important milestones. The first milestone, after 2 months, is a hearing where the robustness of the preliminary thinking on a topic is tested by industry experts, public authorities, and academics. The second milestone, after 3 months, is a meeting with the Think Scientific Council to review the first draft of the report. After the meeting of the Scientific Council, a revised version of the report goes to public consultation. Following this, the report is then finalized.
So you have seen a sample of what Think is. It was a tender opened by European Commission. We did win the tender. We are doing it. We did do already 10 reports for European Commission. And the two last reports will be done next year, first semester. You also saw that Leonardo Meus is taking care of buildings and buildings refurbishment, but along the hills of Fiesole, where refurbishment of building is extremely difficult and costly. Now market design. Market design is known at Furon School because you may remember that we have been asked by the German industrial regulators to look at a possible gas target model. We did propose a gas target model. This gas target model has been, reutilized by SEER, by ESSER, and it has been quite famous. We did try to do the same with electricity. We didn't succeed. We now are trying to do it for electricity and gas, and we are trying to promote a certain way of articulating gas short-term markets, balancing intraday and day ahead with the one of electricity. We have other projects financed by European Commission. All of them coming from open tender with competition. The last one we are in is called Optimate. It is, a software or a model which permits to evaluate alternative market designs for massive integration of renewable. It's a very innovative, very interesting tool. It has been presented in France maybe 1 month ago. We also contribute to paving the way for the Mediterranean Solar Plan when we are a subcontractor for the Italian TSO. When we do not do research, what do we do? But we do the very basic, very old key activity at Furon School, policy debate. Policy debates are extremely important because nobody knows the truth, while researchers think that the truth is somewhere and can be discovered. But when you are a bit older, you know that there is no truth, but there is debate, there is options, there is value, there is interest, there is compromise. How to make it work, and how to make it work with a European value added. That's a big point. And to go deeper into this, we need debate. We now have three types of debate at Furon School. The last one, the newest one from this year, 2012, is a monthly interview.
The market-based is very important because it is one single market price for the entire EU. And unlike many regulatory frameworks that we have, these regulatory frameworks are at the national level. So if we really look for a European dimension, we have the ETS. That is a single carbon market price for the EU, wherever you are, in Poland, in Brussels, in Italy, or in Scotland, it is the same market price. And I think that's a very important benefit of innovating, of giving incentives to innovators in the market.
You have seen Jos Delbecque, Director General for Climate. It should have been Philippe Lowe or Lord Mogg. It depends on the topic we have in mind and the opportunity, because to spare money, we try to interview people where we can do with a limited amount of expense. But every month you have a new interview on our website. We also do the basic, typical policy debate at Foreign School with a dozen of workshops every year, one every month. Our flagship in this area of activity are the workshops organized by Alberto Potocnik, presently director at ESSER, but advisor at the Foreign School since the beginning, since 8 years. Alberto has always been involved in thinking, conceiving workshops at the time of PIPO and at my time. The only difficulty with Alberto is that it is impossible to thank Alberto. That's a typical picture. I am thanking Alberto. After 2 minutes, Alberto is thanking me. This guy is too polite to receive a thanks, except when he's not there. So many thanks, Alberto, to do this on the top of your existing job. Executive seminars. We did think that it's good to have debates. Sometimes it's good to have a debate with 80 people. Sometimes it's good to have a debate with 30 people. Sometimes it's good to have a debate with 12 people or 14. When we target CEOs or directors, directors of regulatory agencies or directors in companies. The first one has been organized by Giorgio at the very end of the table. It was about hosting massive renewable, which regulatory frame. The second one has been an assessment of incentive regulation. How can work incentive regulation if regulators do not have limited resources, but limited resources? How to manage this this fact? And the third one will be next March, next year, and it will address a very interesting topic, which is how to get the proper financing for TSOs. We expect from them to make enormous investment, but how can they raise the money and keep their finance correct given the financial crisis? So we do research. We do policy debate. What else? But what else is quite obvious. We are a school. So what is a school for? To share knowledge. The particularity, but we have this in higher education everywhere, the particularity is that we share knowledge where it's created. We create knowledge by research, we create knowledge by policy debate, and we share this knowledge with whom? You can see with whom 60% of people attending our training are regulators' staff. We are very proud of it. We are a school for regulators, and we are very proud of having regulators attending massively our trainings. And you may also see that 25% are coming from companies. We call them FSR donors because actually their companies are donors. And we are very proud of mixing companies and regulators. I know that in North America, in the US, it could be an enormous scandal to mix companies and regulators. But if you want regulators knowing what is a company, how a company behaves, how a company reacts, they have to know companies. And where could they learn what is a company better than with people from the company? And the opposite is totally true. The companies are very proud of what they do, of their success, etc. But they have to recognize that in Europe, it is a regulated sector. So in Europe, there is a public interest that we define in a certain way, and it is expressed by certain norms, certain rules. So for us, it's better to have people trained this way. Of course, each regulatory commission also has training only for regulators. And personally, we do it, but I will explain in a minute. You may also see that 10% of people attending are academics because we are open. In this room, we have five or six academics having attended our courses. We did do also for the Association of European Consumers, BUC, for free, by the way, but it's normal. And you may see also that European Commission is providing 5% of the attendees, which makes already a lot of people because we train 200 to 300 people a year. So we have every year 10 to 15 people from European Commission. Our flagship in the area of training is coming from one of our founding fathers, Ignacio Pérez Arriaga. Ignacio is a former Spanish regulator. He's currently a regulator in Ireland. But on the top, he's professor of energy regulation at the MIT. He is the professor of energy regulation at the MIT, the real MIT, Boston, Massachusetts, blah, 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 blah. And of course, he is also professor of energy regulation in his own country, Madrid. And Ignacio, every year, is opening and closing, by 2 weeks of training, this annual course, which is a kind of annual professional master with 2 weeks in Florence and 8 months of weekly work at home. And if there is anyone in the room having attended this annual course, you can check with them that there is really homework to do. It's not a party. Another training having created by Leo and me 3 years ago is the training on gas markets. After a while, we did decide, Leo and me, to give it to a real expert in gas regulation and gas markets, Sergio Ascari. And Sergio is now director of this course and he's also gas advisor. And Sergio did help me a lot when I was working on the gas target model, which is very, very kind from him because he did disagree entirely with my model and he did produce another gas target model, but that's academic liberty. Then, total scoop, Leo being there. Leo is now a professor at the Vlerick School, which is a business school. And Leo wants to create, with my full support and participation, a program for grid managers. And the idea is, again, to address real managers of grid companies, saying them, OK, guys, you work in a regulated activity, and with Florence School, you can decipher how works the regulation and the regulators, either at the European Commission or in member states. But also, you are companies, you are really companies, you are not public administration, so you have company strategies for investment, for the management of your people, for your market positioning, and we would like to address both in a coordinated way, because we think that having good, wealthy, regulated companies in Europe is very important for us. If you really believe in the European energy policy or the climate policy, we need strong, wealthy grid companies. And so we would like to contribute to that training, Leo and me, and many other people. Some of you may be interested. Leo is there. You may take Leo at the coffee break. I will drink the coffee, and your break will be with Leo. Fourth example is the summer school in utilities regulation. It is now directed by Carlos Batlier. Carlos Batlier is a Spanish engineer. He's also a researcher, both in engineering and economics. He has been recently a visitor researcher at MIT. Again, I may even tell you that I am permanent researcher at MIT, which doesn't mean that I live at MIT, but I am researcher for a while, let's say. And Carlos is responsible for this summer school, which is also a very big success. And Carlos now is my own advisor for electricity. Let's give an example, capacity markets. I have no time to follow all the intricacy of capacity markets. When I phone or I email to Carlos at 3 a.m., always Carlos answers, which shows that Carlos does not sleep at all. And not the least, Leoncher. Not only Leoncher did create workshops, which are extremely popular today, but she also did create a summer school on energy law and policy. It has been a very big success. And we are very pleased to welcome Leoncher as long as she would like. But by the way, you may see how the gender issue is acute for older people. Not older, sorry, because there is a Lee. Let's say for seniors, because Lee is totally alone among the senior people at Fulham School and Loyola de Palacio Chair, while the young researchers are totally mixed regarding the gender. So it will change, of course, because of age, because we will become older, but it is still a bit, let's say, unsatisfactory that we have so few senior being women. We also do ad hoc training. It's extremely exhausting for us, and it really consumes a lot of resources, but we do with pleasure, even with a smile, because sometimes the regulator needs a particular training only for one time, and they will never again ask for the same. So it's a bit consuming for us. But if we do not do that, how could we claim that we are a school for regulators? We did do for the regulator of Cyprus. We have been extremely pleased. Discussion has been really bright. And the regulator was happy with the outcome. We do it for MEDREG, the Mediterranean regulator, from Turkey to Morocco. Morocco, the regulator is only coming. It's not established yet. We did do in Algeria. That's why you see their IAP. I went to Algeria 5 or 6 weeks. We did train the Algerian regulator. We did also train key managers of the electricity industry who have been extremely pleased doing this. And for a French, it's really a pleasure to do something with Algerians. You may also see the Autorità, the Italian regulators, being the closest friend we have since the beginning in Florence. You may also see ANP, which is a bit strange for you because it is a regulator for biofuel, petroleum, and gas in Brazil. But the regulator for gas did ask us to train the whole staff for gas at the regulatory office. We did do already 1 week. We will do 2 following weeks. And the first week has been an enormous success. We did also try to do with Russia and India. With Russia, finally, we did something else, which is a workshop. And with India, it has been a total failure because at the very last minute, they did disappear totally, and they even did not answer anymore any email. We do not know why. What else? But totally obvious, because the old way of sharing knowledge for academics was publications. So basically, publications did exist, so they are still existing. We have 2 book series. One book series with Claisen Castells Arnoux is there. The orientation is for practitioners, law and policy. We have another series, a bit more academic, but still accessible to practitioners at Edward Elgar. It is called the Loyola de Palacio series. In 4 years, we did publish 9 books with these 2 publishers, and we have other books coming, one coming in the very few weeks, and Arnoux, being in the room, has been extremely innovating and risk-taker as a small entrepreneur, because the next book is in open access, so he prays, and I pray for him, that open access book will be useful for everyone, but also covering the cost for an enterprise. We have also the classical working paper series, 100 in 4 weeks. We did create this new way of communicating ideas, policy briefs. We have about 20 policy briefs and also an annual booklet of policy briefs. It's only 4 pages. In 2 minutes, you know if you like it or not. If you don't like it, you throw it away. If you like it, you can read. 5 minutes, it is read. You know exactly the core of the reasoning and the results. It's a very powerful tool. This is incredible, so you won't believe it. We have 3 journals, being academic journals. The one in the middle is also in cooperation with Claisen Castells, and the orientation is practitioners in law and policy. And the 2 on the left and on the right are typical academic journals. They belong to big international association of economists. The one on the left, the green one, is the International Association for Environmental Economics, and it is the official journal, and it is edited by Daniel Herman, that you have seen a while ago. And the one on the right, the Economics of Energy and Environmental Policy, is the policy journal of the IAEA, 4,000 members. And the journal of the right, the blue one, is edited 5,000 copies each issue. So it's a very big activity. And it is made on the top of the rest. And I was willing to thank again Ernu, who did help us a lot to intervene in the area of energy law. What else? After research, after policy debate, after training, after publications, maybe good to rest, but then you do not know me, you do not know Leo, Annika, and the rest of the team, because we never rest. Everything being meaningful, useful, we do. For example, this was totally involuntary. This year, I got the Yale Electric Award, the Man of the Year. I was not believing it. How could an industry reward a professor of regulation? I did receive my prize from the CEO of Enel and chairman of Yale Electric. Of course, as I am French, I did joke. I did stand up on the chair while receiving the prize. But you know how Italians are charming. The CEO didn't tell me anything and did keep me on my chair. I'm joking. Another type of activity we have, yes, that's the only seminar I've been sacked from. I did attend one or two, and Leo and other young people tell me, but Jean-Michel, you are not a young. I say, okay, I'm not a young engineer, but I am an economist. But it's a, but you are not trained in English. It says young engineers and young economists. Okay, I will quit. So I did quit since 5 years. I cannot attend these seminars. And today it is managed by Michel Alac, being not there, being one of our Brazilian researchers. And like Leo, she has been elected in Brazil full professor. So she will quit us next year to be full professor in Brazil. When we do not do seminars for young people, we do very, very serious, heavy, and luxury conferences like this one. We did do in Palazzo Vecchio in Florence, which is an historic building, the very real city hall from the 11th century and totally painted in the 16th century. And as you can see, we get it open by Director General Law, you didn't see it, also President Barroso, and you do not see it, Director General Del Becker. Just after this very luxury, impressive conference, we did run a conference for young researchers. We did meet 300 young energy researchers in Florence. We do believe in future. We do invest in people being there in 2050 to know whom did make the mistake as to not reach our target. We are opening a totally new activity, e-library. It opens the question of open library. Is it possible for a school to have some or more open access to the publication, hence the innovative initiative with Claes and Castells. We are also opening an encyclopedia which will permit you to address in the vast array of documents we have. We have about 150 documents printed the four last years, plus 500 set of slides. This encyclopedia will permit you to enter into the vast array of documents and immediately identify the ones which could be of interest for you. And on internet, you will get immediate access to the ones you like. We also had more than 1,000 attendees in another new activity. Which one? Webinars. What is a webinar?
This year, Fleming School of Regulation is broadening its training portfolio. We are introducing a new innovative e-learning tool, the FSR webinars.
Our webinars are 1 hour long interactive seminars. The webinars are delivered by experts and focus on current energy issues. You can participate from anywhere in the world, from your office or from your home. All you need is an internet connection and a set of headphones. Webinars are an engaging tool in which instructor and participants interact by asking questions and providing feedback. To register for one of our webinars, you simply follow the link on the FSR website. Registered participants will receive confirmation via email with a link to connect to the seminar.
On behalf of Florence School of Regulation, I would like to invite you to participate in one of our webinars. You can register using the link on our website. We look forward to meeting you online, and until then, warm regards from beautiful Florence.
That's true, beautiful Florence, I won't deny. What else? We are now convinced that online courses may be a winning activity. Maybe you know that Harvard, Princeton, and others did open this last summer online courses. Before the summer, they did get hundreds of thousands attendees. After the summer, today there are millions. Of course, our own school will never get millions. But if we can get 500 to 1,000 people attending our online courses, we will be very proud of contributing to the, not the debate, but the distance training in any country from Brazil to China. Brazil, as you know, is already done. China, we are scratching our head to see how to contribute to regulatory training in this country. Many other activities know that the Energy Transparency Award, thanks to RWE and Statnet, we have been able to run this third edition. The prize will be given in a few hours here. We also have an annual report on transparency. This edition of the report is from Emanuela Michetti, who is now a professor in Latvia. Good luck for her. She is Italian in Latvia. How she will survive, we will see. And she is now replaced or substituted by Sylvester being then in the room. Also, we give prizes to good papers or good PhD. The guy on the left did get the prize. It was €2,000, maybe even €3,000. This guy is Greek. It was the best researcher for us in the whole Europe. And another comment is that that's a typical brain drain. This guy is very good, so where does he work? In London. So that's the internal brain drain working in European Union. That's it. That's all the activity. You may see that we work a lot. How to conclude? But I will conclude that we have very few free time. As we have very few free time, when we want to grow trees, we have to select only this very small Japanese bonsai. Thank you.